I'm Aisha Baumgartner. On today's show, we have a special guest, legendary Indian cartoonist, Sudhir, all the way from India. Welcome to Toronto, Canada. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here.
Tell us, how did you know that you had this talent for drawing, especially drawing cartoons?
I didn't. I just was a, you know, I suppose I was a kind of a doodler or a scribbler or something like that, you know, in my early days. Because I was drawing on the margins of newspapers, you know, because that was space available to me. My mother and father never stopped me. So, you know, I mean, I was drawing faces mainly, you know. And I enjoyed looking at cartoons because we were buying, my father was buying Punch, which was the British humor magazine, which was very popular at that time. And we were also getting, we were subscribing to the Saturday Evening Post, which is a family magazine, you know, from the United States, which had a lot of cartoons. So I got a flavor of British humor and American humor. And I guess I was infected by it.
Is there talent in your family, perhaps your father, your mother, grandparents, who also could draw unbelievably well? Or what would you say is the main factor that influenced you?
My father was a printer. He printed some of Nehru and Gandhi's famous works at the time. This was pre-independence. But he was also a man of various talents. He was a photographer, a very good photographer. He was a master cook. He was an artist. You know, he also painted. So I guess I inherited some of that, but I wish I was half as talented as my father. But I came into cartooning, you know, much later in life. I had a great interest in it, as I said. But it was a tough profession to enter because, you know, there were so few opportunities. You know, you couldn't think of going into the profession unless you got an offer from a newspaper. And how could you possibly suddenly land in a newspaper unless you had the right talent?
So do you think that being an artist or a cartoonist involves having the talent or, as you said, humor?
Well, you have to be a bit of a twit to begin with. You know, you've got to be you have to be crazy as hell. And then you've got to, you know, you should have a talent for drawing. Because if you're just humorous and you can't draw, then how can you be a cartoonist? It's just one of those, I guess it's a God's gift of a kind. You know, you're lucky. There were very few cartoonists in my time, you know, out of a population of millions, you could count them on the fingers of your two hands.
So what would you say is the main reason for all of this success? What would you take along with you in this journey of yours to guide you through to continue with your passion?
There's a great element of luck to begin with. I would never have been a cartoonist, you know, if it hadn't been for a chance meeting with the news editor of the Statesman, you know. I mean, I was a broadcaster, I was working for All India Radio, and he came for a talk. And I was sitting in an adjacent studio. I was the announcer. I saw what I thought was an interesting face, and I started to draw it. And at the end of his talk, I showed it to him. And he said, "My, you made me look almost handsome." He was a tall Englishman. He said to me, "Then, do you draw cartoons?" I said, "Yes, I do." And he said, "Can you show us some?" So I said, "I will." So a few days later, I went to see him.
Were there any days that you felt that you just couldn't go on and you would have to pick another career? Or is it something that you knew from the instant you got that opportunity working on All India Radio and the editor saw your drawing, did you know then that perhaps you could make a career out of this?
Not in that time. Of course, you know, I mean, it is a profession into which you must go with your eyes open, because it's not something that you can treat lightly. It's a serious profession also. I mean, you've got to treat humor seriously, because it's serious business. But you also, you know, you are in two minds. You can be in two minds in the beginning, because, you know, it's if it's going to be a long-term career, whether you'll be able to sustain it, whether you'll be able to stay in it, you know, whether you'll be humorous day after day for a whole lifetime. I spent 40 years in the profession, and it's a great privilege to be on the front page of newspapers for 40 years. You know, you become a friend of you know, a household name. You become a friend of the families. You know, heaps of hundreds of thousands of families, you know, that you've never seen, you will never see. One of the most delightful perks of the job is to be recognized on the street or on the bazaar or, you know, or anywhere, you know. And it's lovely to be stopping at a traffic light and somebody points to you and tells their children, that's Sudhir Dhawan. You know, it's a lovely feeling.
Well, it's clear you have a lot of fans, and I can see why. Your drawings are amazing. And do you think that you could teach our audience the tricks of the trade? If we gave you a sketch pad and a pen, is it something that anyone can pick up and just has to hone the talent, or it's a special gift?
Whether you've got a natural flair for it, because I wouldn't recommend it to anyone who doesn't have a natural flair for it. I mean, there are lots of people who are interested in art, who have a great talent for it. But there has to be a combination of art. I mean, you must have a talent for art, and you must have a talent for, let's say, producing funny things or interesting, lighthearted things, you know. And you must have a keen observation. You must be a keen observer of life. You should be able to look at the odd things in life, you know.
And people, and observe people, and...
Right. I mean, look at their foibles and follies, you know, so that you can highlight them. Because when you begin to do this, the reader begins to identify himself and begins to think of you as a friend, you know, who's reflecting his views, his life, his point of view, and gets into the let's see, you get to establish a much closer relationship with the reader, and you become a friend, a trusted friend.
And do you get what the writers get, which is writer's block? Do you get cartoonist block?
That's a good question. Sometimes, yes. Because, when you're doing this on a daily basis, you know, you're not in the same frame of mind every day. You're not in the same mood. You know, sometimes, you know, you're going through a low period, or you're not really in the mood for humor. But when you have to produce a cartoon a day, you have to get into the mood. I've had moments when I was going through a very bad period. My father was not well. He'd aged. He was dying of cancer, and I was sitting in my room at the office, and I was. Sometimes it was a very painful experience, you know, to be funny, you know, when I didn't want to be funny. So that's what you have to face in life, you know, because that's your profession. But I would recommend it to people, you know, who have a flair. But it's not easy going, you know. You have to sometimes struggle for an idea, which is why a lot of cartoonists are bored, you know. We're pulling our hair out. But all the same, I mean, these have been very rewarding years. I've had occasion to meet some of the world's famous people, you know, and I've had great interaction with them. For instance, I remember I was flying with Indira Gandhi you know, one of the prime ministers of India, during an election tour, I did a sketch of hers. And I said, I must apologize on behalf of all cartoonists, because we've been elongating your nose. Because she had a rather nice nose, you know, very fine nose. She says, you know, I've always had a weakness about my nose. She was going on a trip. She said she was going on a trip to South America, and someone there saw her and said that you're very, very nice to look. You're very nice looking. Somebody else suggested plastic surgery.
But she didn't go ahead with it.
Similarly, you know, I had occasion to meet so many other people, you know, and have so many other experiences. You know. Really, it's been a very rich life. And all these opportunities were made available just because I was on the front page of the newspaper. I had access to so many people.
What do you think of the future of cartooning now?
Well, in India, it's. I'm sad to say, you don't see so many cartoonists, you know, in newspapers, and they've all been pushed into inside pages. You know, there are very few cartoonists now on the front page of newspapers.
Why do you think that is? Is it because you retired?
No, because I guess, you know, it all depends on the. Let's say the caliber of the cartoonist, you know, and you have to prove yourself. You have to justify, you know, position on page one, because page one means that, you know, you're given a certain stature. It gives you a certain stature. It gives you a position. Maybe we'll have to live through another period of depression before we get another golden age, or the right talent comes to the fore.
What about the combination of using computers and technology and mixing that along with the way it used to be, the traditional way, drawing?
Well, you know, our way was the old-fashioned way. You know, we used ink, and we used quills and pens and so on. And that's the only way that I know. You know, I haven't handled computers in this new age of technology. I can only send emails. I can't do more. And I wish those well. I can see the work of the new cartoonists, you know, around the world, who are using computers to tremendous advantage. But, you know, I would still stick to the old. Old is gold.
Tried and true.
Very true.
What do you like the best about the actual process of coming up with a cartoon?
Yeah, that's a good question. Because it's all, you know, you have to create it. You have to create it every day. It requires a great deal of concentration. It requires a great deal of, let's say, you need solitude. You need to think. You need to let your mind run in all directions. There's no magic formula. You can't revolve a cartoon, you know, by following certain steps. But there is a chain, sort of, some steps. For instance, you know, if you get an idea or you pick up a subject, you try and create some other symbol, you know, by which you can then reflect it. But you have to make it appealing. You have to make it apt, or seem that it's seemed like a good idea, something that which a person, a reader, enjoys.
It must be so rewarding when you come up with the final result.
Oh, I can't even describe to you how it feels, you know, when you see the idea, you know, evolving, and you know, you finally give it its shape. And of course, when it gets printed, it's on the front page of a newspaper. It can be very, very uplifting. It can be thrilling. It's really thrilling.
And you do have books as well that are still available at Amazon.ca. Is that correct?
Well, there's some books. I've been rather lazy, because I had a tie-up with Penguin, and I had promised that I would do one book a year, but I did them till about 3 or 4 years ago, and then, you know, I got involved with some other things.
calendars and so forth.
Yeah, yeah, that's right. I got involved with various other things. And, but I'll probably go back and produce a book again.
We'd love that. Anything you'd like to tell our viewers today that would impart some words of wisdom that you've learned over the years?
Well, I don't know if I have any wisdom left, if I ever had any wisdom. Just I guess I was lucky to have the right ingredients. But I would certainly like to recommend it as a profession, because you mean you can be, if you're good at it, you become a celebrity overnight. You know, that's a great opportunity for anyone with a little who's a bit of a nut.
So on that note, I'm sure there are a lot of nuts out there, including ourselves. And we're very pleased to have you here, and thank you very much for your time. You are truly an inspiration, and we'd love to see more of your work, and we enjoy your humor. So thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Aisha. Thank you, very kind of you.